Hello, welcome to Basics of Finite Element Analysis. This is the fifth week of this particular course, and today is the third day in this week. In last class, what we had learned was how do we assemble all our element level equations and bring them to an assembly level. We will continue that discussion further, and what we will learn today is how do we impose boundary conditions on these equations. So, that is one thing we will learn, and second is we will do one more example in context of how to develop assembly level equations. So, we will, so these were our in the last class what we had seen, that these were our assembly level equations. This was the first equation at assembly level, the combo of second and third element equations was the second assembly equation, then this was the third equation and this was the fourth equation. And if we put all these four equations in the matrix form, then our global K matrix is this thing. And you should note that in this global K matrix, we do not have a superscript term, because that whole superscript referred to the element number. So, all we have is K11, K12 and so on and so forth. And then we have this global vector for unknown constants and then global force vector. So, that is there. At this stage, we should again remind ourselves that at the element level, all the assembly level, at the element level, all the K matrices were symmetric. And when we use these matrices to construct the global K matrix, this global K matrix is also, so this is my global assembly matrix, this is also symmetric. This is also symmetric. The third point I would like to make it make here is that you see a lot of zeros in this global K matrix. And this is something you will see again and again in a lot of assembly equations, and we will discuss the reason for this and also what are the mathematical implications for such type of a matrix. So, we will rewrite the global equation. So, K11, K12, 0, 0. This term should be 0, multiplied by global degrees of freedom. Now, what we see is that in our original problem statement, we had broken the domain into three elements, right? Node 1, node 2, node 3, node 4. So, there are 4 degrees of freedom, because each degree, each node is associated with one unknown, which is u. So, there are 4 degrees of freedom and we have 4 equations. So, this is the first thing. So, this is one. The second thing is, so this is the general problem. These equations are valid for all sorts of bar problems, because here we have not given any boundary conditions. It is the boundary conditions which make the things unique. Okay, so these are these are general equations for any one dimensional bar under compression or tension. We can construct K matrix, we can figure out what is F, and these are the Q's. In this general set of equations, how many unknowns we have? So we have 4 U's which are unknown, and then we also have 2 Q's, they are also not known, Q1 and Q4. Everything else in this equation is calculated. So we know everything, we know all the F's, we know all the K's, but what we do not know is U's and Q's. Okay, so there are 6 unknowns and 4 equations. So we have to get, so this will always be the case. If there is if we have n nodes, we will always have n+2 unknowns, and those for a second order boundary value problem. In the second order boundary value problem, we will always have 2 extra unknowns, 2 extra unknowns. Okay, and we get the, so we need 2 extra conditions, we need 2 extra conditions so that we can solve all these 6 unknowns. So those 2 extra conditions come from our knowledge of boundary conditions. In this particular case, we had said that there is a bar, right, and it is being exerted by some force, distributed force, Qfx, and there is an end force, and this is Q naught. Okay, this is the physical statement of the problem. The mathematical statement, so these are the boundary conditions. So what are the boundary conditions? BC1, that bar is fixed at x is equal to 0. This is my x coordinate. So bar is fixed at x coordinates, x is equal to 0, and the second boundary condition is point load at x is equal to L. So this is the physical meaning, right. Mathematically, we had specified 2 boundary conditions, which were these. That, so physically the bar is rigidly fixed, mathematically it means that u is 0 at x is equal to 0. At the other end, A, which is E times cross sectional area times strain, so that is the force, at x is equal to L is Q naught. Okay, so mathematically these boundary conditions mean that u at 0 is equal to 0, and A du over dx at x is equal to L is equal to Q naught. Okay, and actually I am going to pull it Q naught. So this is what it means mathematically, which means that in this equation, in this general assembly level equations, I have to make u at 0 equal to 0, which means that this term is 0. Okay, so this is, once we put this value to be 0, we have enforced the essential boundary condition. Okay, and then we put this value as Q naught. So this is my EBC, I implemented my EBC, this is what I have implemented NBC. This is the primary variable, that is the secondary variable. Okay. So, this is what I do when I specify boundary conditions. There could be some other boundary condition and I again either change the value of essential boundary condition or the value of natural boundary condition accordingly. So, now once I have done this, I have now 4 unknowns and 4 equations, right? 4 unknowns and 4 equations. So, the 4 unknowns are U2, U3 and U4 and Q1, and these are the 4 equations. So, at this stage what I do is, once I have implemented all my boundary conditions, then I only consider those equations where I have not specified the essential boundary conditions. So, I have specified the essential boundary condition in this equation. So, now at this stage I do not consider the first equation at all and I only consider the second, third and fourth equations. Okay. So, here I have 3 unknowns and 3 equations and I solve these guys. Okay. So, I have an assembly level equation n, once I impose the boundary conditions, there is a condensed set of equations for which I have not specified u's. Okay. I only choose those equations, not the other ones where I have specified u's and then I solve for u's. Okay. So, my next step is, once I have implemented the boundary condition, is that solve for u using condensed set of equations. Okay. Once I have solved for u's using condensed set of equations, then once I have done that, then solve for unknown secondary variables. So, first is that we solve for u. Once I have calculated that u, then I plug that u2, u3, u4 in my first equation and I solve for this secondary variable, which is also unknown. Okay. So, first I always calculate primary variable. Once I have figured out all primary variables, then I figure out my unknown secondary variables. So, this is the overall finite element analysis process. And you see that this can be, if we understand this logic, it can be implemented in computers at every stage. You can break a line into 20 different elements, that can be done on a computer, you can develop an algorithm. You can integrate weight functions and their derivatives over the domain of an element and that will help you generate the k element matrix. So, that is automatable. Then you can you have a logic to assemble different equations, which I have explained, that can be automated. And then you have a logic using which we specify boundary conditions and develop a condensed set of equations, that can be automated. And finally, we know how to solve linear equations using computers. So, then I know my primary variable, from primary variable I can calculate q's. So, this entire process can be automated and that is what makes the finite element analysis very powerful. Next, what we are going to do in today's lecture is we will consider one more example. Okay. Now, in the example which we had discussed earlier, it just happened that all the nodes were in one straight line. They were in one straight line, but there is no reason to think that that should always be the case. We can have a one dimensional problem and still nodes need not be in one single straight line. And if that happens, then how do we address those problems and how do we make the logic which we have discussed till so far even more general, so that even if nodes are not in one straight line, we can figure out how to assemble element equations in a methodical and logic programmable way. So the point is that what if nodes are not in a straight line? So we will do an example for that. So let's say I have a bar. I have two bars, two elastic bars, and both these bars are connected with some rigid, undeformable plate, right, or some link. And the middle point of this is connected to a third bar, which is rigidly held at the other end. And for purposes of simplicity, we will consider this entire system as a each bar we will consider that it is one element, just for purposes of simplicity. So this is my element number 1, this is my element number 2, this is my element number 3, and I am going to put node numbers. So this is node 1, this is global node, this is global node 2, this is global node 3, okay, which is same as this point 3, which is same as this point 3, and this is global node 4. And in this system, what I am doing is I am applying a force of P here and another force of P here. So, I am uniformly pulling these bars, stretching and compressing these bars. So, the problem is still one dimensional, because there is no gradient of U in Y direction or Z direction, it is only in X direction. Further, I say that this element length is H1 and this is equal to H2, and this element length is H3. So, we have three elements, each element has two nodes. So, at element level we will have a total of 6 equations, right, we will have a total of 6 equations. So, we will write down those equations. So, k 1 1 1 times u 1 plus k 1 2 u 2 equals f 1 plus q 1, and all these parameters are related to the first element. So, I have a superscript 1, k 1 2 u 1 plus k 1 2 So, this is for element 1. Similarly, I have k 1 1 u 1 plus k 1 2 u 2 is equal to f 1 plus q 1, k 1 2 u 1 plus k 2 2 u 2 is equal to f 2 plus q 2. And all these terms are for the second element. So, you have a subscript of 2. And for the third element, k 1 So, these are the 6 equations. Okay. Now we have to assemble them. We have to assemble them. And what we see here is that things are not in one straight line, right? There are some elements which are connected in parallel, there are some elements which are in series. But the laws of assembly are still the same. So, what are the continuity conditions? What are the continuity conditions? The continuity condition first is that U 1 2 is equal to this is the continuity condition. What does it mean? The displacement of first element's second node is same as displacement of second element's second node is same as displacement of third element's first node. That is the continuity condition. Yeah. Okay. So, what that means is, excuse me, that I replace this variable, also this variable and this variable by U 3 in the equations, right. The second thing is, so this is the continuity condition. The second thing is that I replace these by U 1, these by U 2 and these by U 4, because 1, 2, 3, 4 which are marked in red, they are my global degrees of freedom. So, that is there. The second condition is that the force at node 3 will have three components, right? F 3 is equal to F 2 1 plus F 2 2 plus F 1 3, agreed? And the same thing is true for Q's also. Same thing is true for Q's also. So I have to add which equations? F 1 2, which is this equation, plus F 2 2, which is this equation, plus F 3 1, which is this equation. These are the three equations I will add up, agreed? This is the force balance in this, at this interface, agreed? So, once I add these three equations up, I get an overall K matrix times my global degrees of freedom U 1, U 2, U 3 and U 4, and that I get as some F matrix plus a Q vector. It just happens then in this case, okay, so this is the first case. In this case, is there any externally distributed force in the picture? There is no. So, when we will calculate the values of these F's, they will be 0. Where is force coming from? It is a point load at node 3, right? So, when I do this summation, Q 3 is equal to Q 2 1 plus Q 2 2 plus Q 1 3, this will be equal to 2 p, because I am actually applying a point load which is equal to 2 p at that particular node. So, this is one example where you apply a point load at a node. In that case, the sums of q's does not become 0, okay, then it becomes whatever the force you are actually applying. If you are not applying any external forces, then internal forces will cancel out, they will balance each other and they will cancel out. But here I am applying an external force and that is actually going to drive the displacement in the system. So, this is something I wanted to discuss, and this concludes our lecture for today. In the next lecture, we will continue this discussion and we will look at some other ways which are used to automate the assembly process. Thanks.